else where you have to use both flows at the same time, mean curvature flow and inverse mean curvature flow. So what are the isoperimetric inequalities I'm interested in? The situation you should think of is maybe some manifold. And so here is some Mn plus 1 with some g bar, smooth Riemannian manifold, non-compact. And I will be particularly interested in the case n equals 2. And then we have some boundary of some domain. And we are interested in relating quantities and get isoperimetric inequalities for quantities such as the area of the boundary, the volume of the domain, and integral of certain powers of the mean curvature of this boundary. And here the mean curvature, just like in my last lecture, is the sum of the principal curvatures of the surface. So typical examples in Rn plus 1 would be, of course, the classical isoperimetric inequality, where the area of the boundary to the power n plus 1 over n is bigger than some constant, say, c0 of n times the volume of the domain omega. And when I say c0 here, I mean that you have equality only on balls. The second one that I have in mind is, for example, for n equals 2, there is an important inequality that says that actually on any 2 surface, but certainly on any boundary, the integral of the mean curvature squared, which is now an invariant, a scaling invariant quantity, actually even conformally invariant in R3, is always bigger than 16 pi. Another inequality I have in mind is, say, taking the integral of the mean curvature over the boundary of a domain. And then you get some constant, let's call this C1 of n times the area of the boundary to the appropriate power, which is n minus 1 over n. And again, you have in these cases here equality only on balls around some point. And this inequality was known for convex omega. So one application I have in mind, and let me start with this theorem, is that this inequality, this last inequality, is true for a much more general class of domains. But finally, to put all these in perspective and see that you can even combine them, I want to mention a well-known Sobolev inequality due to Jim Michael and Leon Simon, where they prove that actually on much more general things, but in particular in this case, that on a function u to the n over n minus 1 d mu to the n minus 1 over n, this is less than a constant times the integral of the tangential gradient of u
not quite sure how this works. I hope I didn't break anything. Obviously, I broke it already.
Okay. So you have one term coming from the gradient of the function, and you have another term coming from the geometry of the domain. But this is just a mild term involving the mean curvature of the domain. So this is a Sobolev inequality, which is very crucial in the sense that this constant here in front of the leading gradient term is independent of the geometry of the domain. And in fact, this inequality played a crucial role in what I told you yesterday in getting these a priori estimates. So in some sense, you can see these estimates here. Actually, I got my numbers wrong, right? So this is the bound. It's an absolute value. Yeah, thank you very much. Yeah. So you can see sort of one of these inequalities is interesting if u is equal to 1. And you can also see the so you can sort of see this as in the case where u is the characteristic function of a domain. You can see this as a version of the of this isoparametric inequality, but you can also see it as a version of this one. And it's a completely open question whether you can prove this inequality of Michael-Simon with optimal constants C2 and C3. Right? That's completely open. That would be fantastic if you could make both these two constants optimal. Nobody knows that, and Neil Trudinger actually said to me, I'm far too optimistic. This is hopeless. Why would I expect that? But okay.
Certain. What would that do for you?
I guess it would relate sort of the isoparametric inequality on the surface in an optimal way to the isoparametric inequality of the surface bounding the domain. So it would sort of combine these two isoparametric properties in an optimal way. I think that's the philosophy behind it. Right, so here's the theorem, the first theorem I want to state. So suppose that omega contained in Rn plus 1 is outward minimizing, and I explain that in a moment. Simple way to think about it is its boundary is wrapping omega in the cheapest way possible amongst all possible outside wrappings. Suppose it's outward minimizing, then you have indeed that the integral of the mean curvature over the boundary is larger than the optimal constant C1 of n times the area of the boundary to the n minus 1 over n with equality only on spheres or on balls. Okay. And the definition here of omega contained in Rn plus 1 is called outward minimizing. And say you can even make this with respect to some u in Rn plus 1, can, it's a relative concept, if the area of the boundary of omega intersected with any set K, which is compact, is less than the area of a competitor, omega tilde, intersect with the same K, for all omega tilde containing omega such that omega tilde without omega is contained in K and compactly contained inside this U. In other words, if you if the constraint were not there, it's a minimal surface, but it's only the competitors are only surfaces which are outside the set omega. So in particular, this condition, of course, implies that the mean curvature of the surface is greater or equal to zero on the boundary of omega. But I definitely need this outward minimizing condition here. It is not enough for my proof to just assume positive mean curvature. And it's an open question. So it's open. Is h bigger than zero enough? It would be very interesting if there was a counterexample where this inequality is false on a surface of positive mean curvature, which just does, which is not happening to be outward minimizing. To give you an example of a surface which has positive mean curvature and is not outward minimizing, you can, for example, a torus. And if you make the size of this radius just right to the size of the inner radius, then you can arrange that this torus still has positive mean curvature, but it is not outward minimizing because it is cheaper to put a lid on the top and a lid at the bottom. Yeah? But of course, this torus is not a counterexample to this inequality. The inequality holds. Okay, now, if you have this theorem, turns out you can, for example, get interesting corollaries. So say one corollary is in case n equals 2. So if the boundary of omega is, if omega contained in R3, is outward minimizing, then you can conclude from here that the integral of the second fundamental form minus the average of the mean curvature times 1/2 times the metric squared, the mu, over the boundary of omega, so it's less than 2 times the integral of the trace-free part of the second fundamental form, the boundary of omega. So here I assume that the boundary of omega is diffeomorphic to S2. So we're bounding a ball. And A is the second fundamental form, of course. And H is the integral of the mean curvature average. And A0 is the trace-free part of the second fundamental form. So this is H1j minus 1/2 HGIJ. So what does this inequality tell you? It tells you that the integral of the square of the trace-free part, so this is integral of lambda 1 minus lambda 2 squared, which is a conformally invariant quantity. If that is small, then there is a definite number, h over 2, namely the average of the mean curvature, which all the principal curvatures of A are close to. In this integral, it could, if this is small, a priori it could be that in some region of the surface, lambda 1 and lambda 2 are both large, and in some other region they are both small, and still this is small, right? So this inequality says that can't happen. If this is small, then actually you find a number, namely what you expect, the average of the mean curvature, that they're both close to in the L2 sense. Now this inequality with a very different constant was proved by Camillo De Lellis and Stefan Müller in an earlier work. So De Lellis, Müller prove this with a bad constant coming from the Calderon-Zsigmond theory and from the BMO and Hardy space theory. So they used all that theory to get some constant, and I claim with inverse mean curvature flow in the class of outward minimizing surfaces, you get the optimal constant. Now, once you have that, you get from the work of Delellis and Müller that actually the surface is very close to some standard sphere if you choose the right parametrization. So there is some parametrization of S2 to the boundary such that the parametrization F minus the standard parametrization of S2 in R3 in the W22 norm is less than a constant times this right-hand side of this inequality. And this theorem then in turn, you can view this as a very sharp quantitative generalization of the well-known statement that if the trace-free part of the second fundamental form on a higher dimensional surface is zero, then the surface has to be a round sphere, right? It's like a Liouville, like a rigidity theorem. And this inequality over there gives you a quantitative version of this Liouville theorem in W22. It turned out to be very useful, for example, in asymptotically flat three-manifold to control the position and roundness of constant mean curvature spheres. Maybe I come to that in my second lecture. So this inequality had definite applications. And the inequality follows easily from this theorem if you just work out the squares and apply the Gauss-Bonnet formula. So it's an easy consequence. I guess the nice thing here is that the role of the Gauss-Bonnet formula is nicely separated from the PDE aspects of this inequality. In the work of Delellis and Müller, of course, you also need the Gauss-Bonnet formula somewhere, but it is much more hidden inside the proof. Okay. So now, how to approach the proof? For that, we have to use inverse mean curvature flow. Yes.
How was the outward minimizing then convexity?
Sorry?
The convex domain satisfies the outward minimizing, I guess.
Sure, yes.
Any how close is the condition then convexity?
Oh, it's quite a, I mean, outward minimizing is much weaker, of course, than convexity, right? So, I mean, say a surface, it's not hard to find a surface like, I guess clearly this surface, for example, is outward minimizing. You cannot wrap it in a cheaper way. Yeah. Actually, I should make a patent out of this and sell this to the packaging industry, because this inverse mean curvature flow has the nice property that given any surface in R3, it will find for you the area minimizing out hull. In other words, it will find for you the cheapest wrapping of the surface. And let me explain how it does that. But is that example accepted? Yep. Yeah. So, I mean, in higher dimensions, there is no comparison between convexity and this condition, right? It's far, far weaker. So inverse mean curvature flow, let me first show you classically. So given some smooth initial surface, let's call it NN0, sitting in some Riemannian manifold, you with a positive mean curvature, you want to solve ddt of f of pt. So we want to move this thing, have some initial position. You want to put this equal to 1 over h times the exterior unit normal to the surface. Right? So here's the surface. Here is nu. And I've chosen signs such that the mean curvature of a sphere is positive. So if you want to write this in an invariant way, this is minus the mean curvature vector divided by the mean curvature squared. And with initial data equal to this f0 of p. We want to move the surface now in the other direction. That's why I call it inverse mean curvature flow. You go the other direction, outward rather than inward. And you take the speed also to be the inverse. Now, it turns out if you look at the linearized operator, these two minus signs cancel. And the linearized operator that is relevant here is the operator 1 on h squared Laplace on the right-hand side. So as long as the mean curvature is positive, the right-hand side is an elliptic operator on f, and this is a parabolic system, more nonlinear than the mean curvature flow, but it's still parabolic, and you get short-time existence under this condition. And a good example would be if you start with a sphere. So if your initial surface is some sphere of radius r0 in rn plus 1, in this special case, you get the surface expanding out. And you get spheres, of course, again. And the surface nnt is a sphere of radius r of t. And you can compute that r of t is just exponentially growing. It's the initial radius times e to the t over n. I'm not lucky with this.
And, try once more.
Okay, so spheres expand exponentially to infinity. And this property of exponential growth, in particular, can be seen to be general on general surfaces concerning the area. So by just differentiating this equation, we can compute ddt of the induced metric, ddt of the curvature, and so on. And the key observation we make is that ddt of the area element on the surface is just the area element. So point-wise, you have exponential growth of the area. And in particular, this means that the surface area is just completely determined by the initial data, even in the general case, not just in the spherical case. That's just the first variation formula. Variation of area is the mean curvature times the speed, and the speed is the inverse of mean curvature. So if you like, you can also make this condition here the defining equation of the flow. Now, the other thing you can compute for this flow is that now the mean curvature satisfies, again, a reaction diffusion equation. Turns out you get a divergence term, which has very fast diffusion if the mean curvature becomes small. And then you have a reaction term coming from the second fundamental form, which looks like this in Euclidean space, and which has an extra term coming from the Ricci curvature of the ambient space. You get this equation for the mean curvature. Now, this equation is, when you first look at it, it looks nice, because here you have a nice divergence form elliptic operator. This is a negative term, and this seems to be lower order if the curvature of the ambient space is bounded. And indeed, you can conclude from this easily that the mean curvature has to be bounded from above by a constant that only depends on n and the initial data. And the ambient manifold, of course, yeah. The ambient Ricci curvature. So the upper bound for the mean curvature now is no problem. But that's not a surprise, because the surface is expanding. The issue is the lower bound. And the lower bound, that's where it looks bad, because you see, this term here is huge if h is small. And the a squared is the second fundamental form. So if you form a singularity, this could again be huge. So this term here can indeed make the mean curvature possibly blow up in finite time. And in fact, if you start with a torus like this, which has positive mean curvature, this will happen, right? Because the torus has positive mean curvature, so it grows outwards. As it grows outwards, the mean curvature becomes smaller, so the surface speeds up, grows even faster. Something has to break. And in fact, somewhere the mean curvature goes to zero, the speed goes to infinity, and you're lost. So this can happen, and it will happen. What one can prove, however, is a proposition that I proved with Tom Ilmanen. And this says that as long as the mean curvature is bounded below, everything is smooth. So what I just said is the only thing that can go wrong. Yeah? Smoothness, as long as h is strictly positive. You can only get a singularity if the speed goes to infinity. Actually, this was found by Smocic in the case n equals 2. So that's one result. We know what we have to watch out for. Zero mean curvature is the enemy. And
what do you mean by singularity here?
That the second fundamental form, the curvature, becomes infinite.
Mean curvature goes to zero, but the second, okay.
Yeah.
But the curvature goes.
In fact, as long as the mean curvature is larger than some little delta, I can extend the flow pass for a further time interval. That's a more precise statement. So it cannot happen that the mean curvature stays bounded from below by some positive delta, and the second fundamental form goes to infinity.
So it's probably compensation between negative and positive eigenvalues.
Right, yes, you have to do the evolution equation for the eigenvalues and look at the exact right combination. In fact, you have to look at something like mean curvature times the smallest eigenvalue of the second fundamental form and play with that. Right, so we know how to characterize singularities. And there's one theorem, actually very nice, quite a number of years back by Klaus Gerhardt, where he shows that if the surface is star-shaped, there's no singularity whatsoever. So if the initial surface sitting in Rn plus 1 is star-shaped and has positive mean curvature, then Nnt exists for all positive time and tends to large spheres at infinity. With a priori estimates telling you that the surface become more round and so on. And so if you rescale, everything converges to a round sphere. So it's sort of the complete analog of the theorem I told you 2 days ago, mean curvature flow. If you start with something convex, it contracts and it becomes round at the end in some finite time. So this guy, if it's star-shaped and has positive mean curvature, so I don't even need convexity. Actually, I had a proof for the convex case, and Klaus Gerhardt trumped me with the star-shaped thing. So then it starts expanding, and eventually it becomes convex, actually, and then it converges exponentially after rescaling to a round sphere. It will remain star-shaped. That was the key observation of Klaus Gerhardt, that star-shapedness is a preserved property under the flow.
It becomes
in finite time, it becomes convex here. Okay. The point is, it really converges to a round sphere. So now I can show you that computation that gives you hope of proving the main theorem. So here's the computation. In fact, you can do it for any alpha greater or equal than 1. You can compute. Now, suppose you have some surface, some solution of the flow, and you just take the integral of h to the alpha d mu over the surface divided by the area of the surface to the power n minus alpha over n. So this clearly makes the quantity scaling invariant. Now you just use the formulas that I wrote up here on this board. Just put it in. Let's do it. So we get 1 over nn to t to the n minus alpha over n. Then here we get a alpha integral h to the alpha minus 1 times the divergence of 1 on h squared di h d mu. That's one term. And then you get from the measure term a term plus integral h to the alpha d mu. And then from the denominator, you get plus alpha minus n over n times integral h alpha d mu. Right? That's exactly what you get. And then you integrate this one by parts, and you see this is 1 over this area to the n minus alpha over n times minus alpha times alpha minus 1 integral h to the alpha minus 4 gradient h squared d mu. And now I forgot the absolute term up there in Rn plus 1. The Ricci term is not there, but I have to put in this term, right? So I have minus integral alpha minus alpha integral h to the alpha minus 2 times a squared. I forgot this guy. And then this one I've integrated by parts. That's this one. Now the h to the alpha term is killed by the n over n term here. So this guy is gone against this. And now alpha over n times h to the alpha, that's just the trace part of this term. Remember, a squared is the trace-free part plus the trace part. All right? So the trace part from here cancels the alpha term there. So we are just left with alpha times integral h to the alpha minus 2 times the trace-free part squared d mu. So the whole thing is less or equal to 0 with equality if and only if these two terms are 0. That means we are on the round sphere. So the inverse mean curvature flow decreases this quotient. Now this immediately gives a theorem in the star-shaped case in view of Klaus Gerhardt's theorem. Right? You just take any surface, n0. There is a solution for all time. Along the solution, this quotient is decreasing. As we tend to infinity, we get the sphere. It's a scaling invariant quantity. Therefore, at time 0, this quantity must have been larger than the corresponding quantity of the sphere. And this proves then this inequality in that case. So therefore we get, if the NN0 is star-shaped, then we get that the integral of H alpha d mu is larger than the optimal constant, depending of course on N and alpha, times the area to the N minus alpha over N. But, of course, I have to use the star-shaped condition here. Actually, therefore, this was also observed, and for other geometric quantities in the star-shaped case by Peng Fei Guan, co-author. Yeah.
So can you see that this derivative, without doing a calculation, is it intuitively clear that this should be negative, or do you really have to do the calculation?
You have, well, I'm not as good as I can just, no, I had to do the calculation, yeah. And it's a miracle somehow.
Yeah.
See, the same thing does not work for mean curvature flow. You see, you could hope. Why doesn't he do it with mean curvature flow, right? I mean, I could have said, okay, I contract inwards and try the same thing. Doesn't work. But I will show you later in the second lecture that we can exploit the results that I get from inverse mean curvature flow, put it into mean curvature flow, and then use this inequality that I proved using inverse mean curvature flow to give a new proof of that one using mean curvature flow. So, yeah?
So if I remember correctly, in the work of Guan and Li, then they used the regular variant on the mean curvature flow, not the inverse one, to prove this theorem for non-negative mean curvature. So you write here an open question, is it enough? So if you add star-shapedness, then this is enough by their theorem.
Right? And positive mean curvature.
And yeah, positive mean curvature.
For
and star-shapedness does imply this theorem, and I think they use...
Yeah, that's there.
Yeah, exactly, that's there. But they use the regular...
So who is that?
Peng Fei Guan and...
No, you use inverse mean curvature flow, right?
Inverse.
Yeah, and they also do it for other curvature quantities. Yeah. But it's inverse mean curvature. It doesn't work with mean curvature flow. Yeah. Yes, Peng Fei.
Sorry?
Well, it's equivalent. It's the same. If you can normalize the mean curvature flow. No, it doesn't help.
Okay.
It's just no, it doesn't help. No. Definitely not. Right. Yeah.
Either you riskier normalization as this, riskier than both.
Right. There is certainly no such calculation that I'm aware of that would give it, right? That because you get competing terms, you get sort of extra good gradient terms, but then you get bad zero order terms, and these two terms cancel out if you're on the round sphere, but you don't see that one against the other if you're not on a round sphere. So I see no way of getting this proof for mean curvature flow. Whereas for inverse mean curvature flow, you get something where both the gradient term and the reaction term pull in the same direction.
The question I think Bengangio has a student somehow, I don't remember the name, but somehow he used the mean curvature flow in certain kind of normalization to pull the anthropometric time going
forward. I had a student, Felix Schulze. Yeah. So I talk about this, how you use mean curvature flow to prove these type of inequalities in my second lecture. Yeah. So the challenge is to now prove this theorem without the star-shapedness assumption, right? So as I showed you, there are singularities happening, say in this example, and you can easily make this example into a sphere and still get an example value of a singularity. So you have to have a solution of inverse mean curvature flow which can deal with singularities and where you can still justify this computation. That's the key point. So find a weak solution. Where the computation is still justified. Okay. And this was developed by myself and Tom Ilmanen. And we use the level set method, so we want to represent the surface to be the set of all points in the ambient space where some function u of p is equal to t, but life is not so easy, so we take the boundary of the set where u is less than t, because we have to allow for the possibility of plateaus, and then we want to take the left-hand side of the plateau. So u is going to be a function on nn plus on m, sorry, m n plus 1 g bar outside our domain omega into the reals. And in fact, we want u to be greater or equal to 0. And we want u on the boundary of omega, this is u restricted to the initial surface, to be 0, of course. U is going to be the time when the surface passes through. And then when you translate inverse mean curvature flow into an equation for u, the equation you get is divergence of mod of du over mod du equals mod du. Why? See, du over mod du is the unit normal to the level set, and the divergence of the unit normal to the level set is the mean curvature, and mod du is the inverse speed. So the inverse speed is the mean curvature. So this trick allows you to consider this 1 over h equation, which looks bad, as a actually elliptic equation. You pull the h up, write it upstairs in this form. Of course, this equation here is strongly degenerate in two ways. First of all, this doesn't make sense if mod du tends to 0, and we have a plateau of u. And secondly, even if mod du is equal to 0, this will be degenerate in the direction of the unit normal. Has to be. We cannot turn a parabolic equation into an elliptic equation, even where the solution is smooth. So this is a degenerate elliptic equation with the added difficulty at the points where mod du is equal to 0. Right? So this is but this is the problem. Degenerate elliptic, So let me show you how the picture looks like. So in particular, if you have the
Where is the derivative of t of u disappear?
It's gone. It's gone. See, the u is the time when the surface passes through. We added one dimension. See, u is a function on Rn plus 1. So we're looking essentially for the graph of u, which is now n plus 1 dimensional, rather than for a family of n-dimensional surfaces.
Right.
So this still carries all the information of the whole flow.
U depends on time.
No. Just the level sets of u. I know there is another level set formulation, say, for mean curvature flow, where the function also depends on time, and then all the level sets move by
so
the flow.
Sliding along the u. U is fixed, but you're sliding along the u.
Right. Yeah. I give it to you. So the example would be exactly this one there with the spheres, right? So if the initial surface is the sphere of radius R0 around some point, around the origin, right, then we said that we have R of t equals R0 times e to the t over n. So I just solve this for t, and I get u of x is a function just depending on mod x, and it is simply minus n log mod x over R0. Not minus, it's a plus sign. And I get then that the picture looks like this. Here is this extra z direction. Here is Rn plus 1. Here is the origin. Here is the initial sphere. And then the u will look like this. Alpha phi, okay. And the level sets give you the level sets of this function, then give you the surfaces going out at an exponential rate. So what we have to construct is really these graphs. This is what we have to find. And now the point is to now really turn this, this is really the main idea, to really turn this originally parabolic problem, which we have now written as a degenerate elliptic problem, turn it into a strictly elliptic problem. So really change the nature of the equation, turn it into something strictly elliptic by using elliptic regularization, right? So we look at the problem epsilon, where we take divergence of du epsilon over square root epsilon squared plus du epsilon squared equals epsilon times square root epsilon squared plus du epsilon squared. With the same boundary conditions on the interior. But now we have to be careful, because if we introduce this epsilon, then we cannot solve it anymore on the whole. So we have to prescribe the u, say, on the ball of radius 1 over epsilon to be equal to some number, which I'm not going to discuss at this moment. You use this number, you guess what this number should be, for example, from a comparison solution like this log function. So you now have a strictly quasi-linear parabolic elliptic equation. You have an elliptic equation, quasi-linear, in a bounded domain. And now, turns out that this equation not only has sort of good analytic properties, it can be reinterpreted in a geometric way if you do a rescaling. So if you now introduce u hat epsilon is u epsilon over epsilon, if you do this crucial rescaling, in other words, you now stretch the graph in the extra z direction with the epsilon parameter, then this epsilon here cancels out completely, and you end up with divergence of du hat epsilon over square root 1 plus du hat epsilon squared equals epsilon square root 1 plus du hat epsilon squared. With the boundary conditions. But this is now a well-known geometric quantity. This thing here is the mean curvature of the graph of u hat epsilon, one dimension higher. This is the mean curvature of the graph of U hat of this graph here. And this one here is just the angle. It's 1 over the cosine of the angle between this unit normal here and this ddz direction there. This angle here is just the cosine of that is just 1 over this. Now, if you think about that, what that means is this equation describes another solution of inverse mean curvature flow, namely a solution 1 dimension higher, which is translating downwards with speed 1 over epsilon. So this equation here says that the graph of u hat epsilon minus epsilon minus 1 over epsilon times t is a translating solution of the original smooth flow. Let's just call it the smooth inverse mean curvature flow in Rn plus, in actually this also goes on Riemannian manifolds, in Mn plus 1 cross R. In other words, the idea of regularization turns the weak equation for the level sets in the n plus 1 dimensional manifold into a completely smooth evolution by just translating downwards in the cross product of the original manifold with R. So we've turned sort of a singular problem in n plus 1 dimensions into a completely regular problem by paying with one extra dimension. The advantage is that we now have all the formulae available, one dimension higher, that we have for smooth inverse mean curvature flow, right? So we don't have to start with our work anew. We can use everything we know, that Klaus, all the estimates that Klaus Gerhardt has established, and all the equations. All these things can be used now on our approximating solutions. Now, it's of course not completely trivial that you can solve it for positive epsilon, but that's sort of fortunately established theory for quasi-linear prescribed mean curvature equations.
What does the outward minimizing come in this picture?
It doesn't, well, okay. The outward minimizing comes in to the properties of the weak solution. So yeah, let me maybe state the result. I can't go through everything. So these guys here, maybe let me draw the picture and then state the result. So here we have the z direction. We have this initial surface and zero. That's the original domain. And then we have constructed first the graph of the u epsilon. And then we have tremendously rescaled the thing. So now we have the graph of the u hat epsilon, all right? And they are all smooth solutions. And the claim is that as the epsilon tends to 0, that you then get a vertical cylinder . So this is as epsilon tends to 0, these steeper and steeper graphs of u hat epsilon turn into a vertical cylinder while still being solutions of inverse mean curvature flow all the time. So the claim is that this now converges to a weak solution of inverse mean curvature flow of these vertical cylinders, But since it's a vertical cylinder, you can ignore one direction, just look at the cross section, giving you a weak solution of inverse mean curvature flow downstairs. That's the concept. I have to tell you what is a weak solution. Right? So a weak solution, you have to make this limit, you have to have the right notion of weak solution. Otherwise, you don't get a compactness theorem that allows you that to extract this limit, this vertical cylinder. So you need the right notion of weak solution that survives this this machinery. Right? So here's the definition of weak solution. U of this degenerate elliptic equation. Here, let's call this W for weak. A weak solution of W means consider the functional J K U of V. So this is integral mod dV plus V mod dU d volume over K sitting in M n plus 1. Okay, look at this functional which depends on the functional U. So you take some U, and for U, you look at this functional. This functional has the property that the first term gives you this divergence term here as an Euler-Lagrange equation. So this thing here, divergence du over mod du, is the Euler-Lagrange equation of this thing here. And the right-hand side, of course, is not the Euler-Lagrange equation of anything. So we artificially freeze this thing, treat it as a bulk term. And if we fix this for a moment and vary just v, then, of course, this becomes the Euler-Lagrange term of that second term. So the notion of weak solution simply now requires that the jk of u of u is less than the jk u of v for all v with the support of the difference of u and v sitting inside this k and sitting inside this u. So this would be a weak solution of w in some domain u. So in other words, the concept of weak solution doesn't require the function to be an absolute minimum of some variational problem. Rather, it is some kind of stability with respect to itself. We want it to be optimal with respect to itself, and itself means if you put in this bulk term. It's like sort of minimizing area with respect to a volume constraint. In this case, it is minimizing area with respect to the constraint that the surface is lying outside itself. And that's where the outward minimizing comes in. So this extra term here make sure that we don't get just minimal surfaces. If this wasn't there, we would get minimal surfaces. But this constraint here makes sure that we get surfaces which are outward minimizing. So from this thing here, any such solution, you prove that the level sets n and t are all outward minimizing. That's where it comes in. And the other thing you prove is that the area for all positive t is continuous. So you prove the area n and t is continuous in t for all positive t. Okay? But you cannot expect it to be continuous if the initial surface is not outward minimizing. It will immediately jump to the outward minimizing hull. Yeah? So it is exactly continuous at t equals 0 if the initial surface is outward minimizing.
And it's not smooth.
Sorry?
And it's not smooth in general, unless you have convexity.
Oh, no. In general, the u will only be, say, C0, C01. So, yeah. So n and t So this is crucial. It's continuous in t equals 0 if the initial surface NN0 is outward minimizing. No, otherwise it will. The theorem says it. The next surface is outward minimizing. All the others are outward minimizing, so it will jump immediately to the outward minimizing hole. Yeah. It's outward minimizing. And now this is of course crucial, because in this when you look at this calculation, if I want to make this work for the weak solution, I need the area term, which plays an important thing. I need the area term to be continuous and not jump up. That would kill the argument.
Differentiability also.
No, well, I don't need the differential. I will replace this by just difference quotients, right? But I need that the area cannot jump up. The mean curvature, the integral of the mean curvature will be allowed to jump down, right? So a typical example to think about it is you start with this torus, right? If you start with this thin torus, then after a while it becomes a more thick torus. And if this goes on for a while, at some stage, it simply becomes cheaper to put the lid on the top and the lid on at the bottom. And this will happen exactly at that instant where this doesn't change the area, so that the area remains continuous. Right? So you have not changed the area. The area here in this object remains continuous in this violent moment where everything jumps. But the integral of the mean curvature, or the mean curvature squared, drops because you've replaced a piece of positive mean curvature by a piece of zero mean curvature. And therefore, this thing drops, this one doesn't jump up, therefore you maintain this monotonicity. That is sort of, in a nutshell, the result. Oh, my dear. So with this concept of weak solutions, we can get the existence, and we can then do exactly this calculation here, this calculation over there, in the graphs of U hat epsilon. So we do this calculation that I did there, one dimension higher, on the graph of the U hat epsilon, and pass it to the limit. And the thing that is, and I did that with Tom Ilmanen for n equals 2 and integral h squared. And the thing I wanted to show you, and ran out of time because you asked so many interesting questions, is that this calculation not just works for two-dimensional surfaces in R3 and integral h squared, but you can do it for any power of h. So you can do integral h to powers alpha, which are strictly bigger than 1, because as long as you have a power alpha here, strictly bigger than 1, you get a good term here, you still have a good gradient term. And now, of course, the problem is that if you do this computation one dimension higher and you want to reduce it finally to the cross section, you have to introduce a cutoff function in the z direction. The cutoff function in the z direction will introduce all sorts of error terms into this equation. In particular, it will introduce cross terms between the gradient of the cutoff function and the gradient of the mean curvature. Now, these terms you can only handle as long as this good term is there. Turns out, as long as the alpha is strictly bigger than 1, the error terms can be handled. And on the right-hand side, the real error terms, so this is for the experts, the horrible error term that occurs is the integral over the n hat epsilon t from some time t1 to some time t2 of 1 over h d mu dt. And this doesn't happen if you just look at the work that I did with Tom Millman, and we didn't get such a bad term. But if you really want to let the alpha go to one, then you have to deal with this thing. And the nice thing is that this here, it looks first horrible, but then 1 over h is the speed. So this is the change of the volume, and this is the integral of the change of the volume. So you can estimate this thing in a very geometric way by the up to any given time interval. You can estimate it by the volume, by this. So this is less than this volume in the n plus 2 dimensional space that is swept out by the graph of u hat epsilon. And this argument gives you an upper bound on this for each positive alpha. And then you establish the inequality that I claimed in the theorem for each positive alpha. And then finally, you argue that after some finite time, the surface is smooth outside some big compact set. And then you can let alpha tend to 1, and you recover the original theorem. So the key hard work is making this estimate work with introducing a cutoff function, controlling these error terms, controlling this double integral, and then letting epsilon tend to 0 and justify this inequality in this general setting. Thank you very much. That's, I think that's open, yeah.
Yeah. So this condition means that it's equivalent to being locally outward minimizing. Is that enough for your method?
No. I don't think so. Locally outward minimizing is almost the same as positive mean curvature. We're dealing with global. That's why I think a counter example would be so illuminating, and so it because it has to be of global nature, right? It would have to be something very funny in higher dimensions, having positive mean curvature everywhere.
But you believe there is a counter example that it's not true.
There's a lot of space in high dimensions, so. Yeah. I thought about it, yeah. I have some ideas what it might be. We can talk about it, yeah.
Maybe
yeah.
Use a scalar curvature.
Yeah, it would have to be only in cases where you have some positivity conditions, like positive Ricci or positive sectional even. I think there are some candidates because, I mean, you want to. You might think of something like ddt gij equals minus rij over r or something like this, right? Because then the trace, you again end up with ddt dmu is dmu. This seems to be the crucial thing. Yeah, so if you do something like this, you might, you can certainly make sure you get this. And I checked that if you put certain curvature conditions, then this is even an elliptic flow. But it is much more nonlinear than Ricci flow. So to even get short time existence, non-trivial. Yeah.
So you cannot invert the matrix RIJ?
I haven't tried to use something like the inverse of the Ricci curvature. No, I haven't tried that. Right, it's the same notion. It's exactly the same notion. All that, yeah. I apologize that I spent so much on time on this. So this is the old notion and the old concept. The new thing is to push the monotonicity formula down to alpha less than 2 to show that you really can go with alpha all the way down to 1. Yeah, because for alpha equals 1. you don't even have this good term anymore, right? So how to justify this calculation for alpha equals one? That's that was the hard part. And that, I have to use these cutoffs, and it took me, I thought I was lost because I got these horrible integrals, but then I realized that I can relate this double integral to the volume that has been covered by the graph of u hat epsilon. And this estimate works for any alpha, all the way down to one. Yeah, that's the key news, the key observation that you can use simply you have an argument that there's only a finite amount, a finite strip here in this higher dimensional space, and the volume of that strip can be bounded uniformly for each finite time interval, and then you can pass in each finite time interval to the limit because you have this bound on this double integral. That's the new estimate.
What about the application to Euler delays with that?
Right, so with this method, then you get the estimate integral h bounded below, and then you put this, combine this with Gauss, follows immediately with Gauss-Bonnet. Then, yeah, all right. And it seems, and there also for that constant, there seems to be no counterexample. Seems to be the best possible constant. That's two. Yeah. I don't know whether that has any meaning in these asymptotically flat situations. It's a much sharper estimate. It seems to be the sharpest estimate that I know to control the roundness of two spheres which are almost round. There's nothing lost, right? And you only, and see the right-hand side, integral a0 squared, is something you can get your hands on. For example, in the constant mean curvature foliation, this term can be estimated from a stability estimate, right? Yeah, so you can sort of see a cascade of arguments where you start with integral a0 squared, then you get the position estimate from this W22 estimate, and you can go on from there and have a better control, the best possible control on your foliation of two spheres near infinity. That's why I think this is. So, for example, Jan Metzger was able to use that estimate to improve the result on CMC foliations I had with Yao by two orders of differentiability.
Thank the speaker.